Federico Seneca was one of Italy's most distinctive 20th century masters of poster art. But for some reason outside his home country, his memory hasn't endured as well as it should have. He was born in the town of Fano in 1891, and he studied at the Royal Institute of Fine Arts in Urbino until 1911. He then took a job teaching art, and also began to tentatively try his luck creating posters. Although he had some limited success, there was little about these early images that was particularly memorable. But having been fortunate enough to survive his time as a pilot in the Great War, he began to develop an altogether more radical and distinctive stylistic approach. In 1920, Seneca started working in the advertising studio of the chocolate manufacturers Perugina, and it was with his work for this company that his style began to evolve. It was far from an overnight transformation, but his images became increasingly abstracted, and in particular the art movement Futurism, which was prevalent in Italy at the time, had an obvious influence on his output. Also prevalent was the rise of Italian fascism under Mussolini, and there are some examples of his graphic support for the movement. In 1925, the company merged with the pasta makers Buitoni, and naturally enough, Seneca started creating similarly daring posters for them too. And between these two divisions of what had become the same corporation, he was kept more than busy for the next 12 years, up to 1933, when he left to set up his own advertising agency in Milan. And although working independently, he was in the fortunate position of having Perugina and Buitoni as continuing clients, while steadily building a broader client base. Among them were several of Italy's more high-profile businesses, many of whom were also from the food and drink industry, although there were also several mainstream Italian industrial manufacturers. But in 1936, for reasons I can't imagine, he dissolved the company and set up a new business venture working in plastics. And he didn't return to creating posters until 1950, when his plastics business eventually floundered. And for the rest of his career, he worked as a consultant for another advertising agency, and enjoyed yet more success in that capacity, with very successful campaigns for a long line of major clients up to 1958. What he did after this, I have no idea, although there is visual evidence that he also created sculptures. But whether these were created before or after the illustrations, I haven't been able to find out. And the only information I could find out about his later life was that he retired to a small town just south of Lake Como in 1969, and he died in 1976 at the age of 85. French illustrator and artist Edy Legrand was born as Edouard Léon Louis Warshawski in Bordeaux in 1892 to a French mother and a Jewish Russian father. After finishing his studies at the École des Beaux-Arts in Paris and the Art Academy in Munich, Legrand lived and worked in Paris as an illustrator, almost exclusively in publishing. In 1919, when he was 27 years old, he published his first children's book, Macao et Cosmage, subtitled The Experience of Happiness. This was a series of highly stylized exotic images which were coloured using the pochoir stencil method in collaboration with the printmaker Jean Saudet. This collection is rightly now seen as one of the milestones in the history of illustrated children's picture books, and it's been reprinted numerous times since. There's no doubt that this book was considerably ahead of its time and has proved to be remarkably influential. His next publishing success was Voyages and Glorious Discoveries of the Great French Navigators and Explorers in 1921, which featured a series of brightly coloured angular illustrations and a wide variety of aesthetically considered page layouts. But despite his success as an illustrator, he simultaneously followed a path as an artist and enjoyed success in that capacity too. In 1926, Legrand's illustrated edition of Pierre Dominique's Les Danubiens was published with a series of deceptively gestural line and wash drawings. And using a similar but far more detailed technique, he illustrated the children's story The Lion's Glasses, written by Charles Vitrac and published in 1932. The following year, he travelled extensively throughout Europe and North Africa, and spent at least some of any given year in Morocco for the next two decades. Legrand's visualisation of Dante's Divine Comedy was published in 1938, and this series of dramatic monochromes successfully brought this vision of hell to life. And the following year, he was commissioned to produce five volumes of Shakespeare's tragedies for the George Macy Limited Editions Club. I can find no record of what Legrand did during the Second World War, but once the war had ended, he spent a large part of the 1950s in New York, from where he continued his association with the Limited Editions Club and created illustrations for several other American publishers. Among many highlights were the 12 watercolours he created for The Plague by Albert Camus, published in 1950. And in the same year, his illustrations for Cervantes' Tale of Don Quixote was published by the Heritage Press, and this series of complex line and subtle wash images was quite rightly critically acclaimed as a highly distinctive visualisation of the narrative. In the 1950s and 60s, a large volume of Legrand's output focused on religious themes. He produced an extensively illustrated edition of the Bible with a series of suitably thoughtful and dramatic monochromes. And he also created a contemporary interpretation of the medieval book The Imitation of Christ. The last published work I found is 1964's The Small Flowers of St. Francis of Assisi. And Edy Legrand died in 1970 at the age of 78 in Bonneur in the south of France. American illustrator and author Helen Sewell was born in 1896 in Mare Island, California, into an affluent family, although she spent a lot of time on the island of Guam, where her father was the governor. Tragically, she was orphaned at the age of 8 and was subsequently taken in by another already large family. She later studied at the Pratt Institute, and her first book was published in 1923 when she was 27 years old. The book was The Cruise of the Little Dipper and Other Fairy Tales, written by Suzanne Langer. It contained many simple but effective line illustrations throughout, and it proved to be the first of many, some of which she wrote and some of which were written by others. Ahead for Happy, which she also authored, was published in 1931, with some agreeably absurd monochrome spot illustrations, and a radically minimal use of text that has now become commonplace but was far from usual at the time. And in the following year, she illustrated Little House in the Big Woods, the first of several books for the writer Laura Ingalls Wilder. This proved to be a very productive partnership, and their collaboration produced quite a few more, such as Farmer Boy in 1933, and 1935's Little House on the Prairie, which was later made into a long-running TV show. Sewell was remarkably prolific, and 1934 saw two publications, with Blue Bonnets for Lucinda, written by Francis Clark Sayers, which was popular enough to be reprinted several times, and in the same year a version of Cinderella, for which I can only find the cover. Peter and Gretchen of Old Nuremberg by Viola Jones was published in 1935, and this book contained a particularly distinctive and attractive set of images which combined hatching and stippling techniques with an attractive limited palette of flat colours. In 1936, Ten Saints, written by Alan Afarjon, was published, featuring a series of highly stylised colour illustrations evoking medieval woodblock printing. And in 1937, she returned to the softer side of her technique with American editions of The Magic Hill and The Princess and the Apple Tree, both written by Winnie the Pooh author A.A. Milne. Sewell tackled more adult fiction in 1940 with her stipple monochromes for Jane Austen's novel Pride and Prejudice. And in 1942, she created some dynamic and once again quite angular two-colour illustrations for the Book of Myths. She returned to more expected children's material with Elizabeth Coatsworth's The Big Green Umbrella in 1944, and her creativity and productivity showed no signs of diminishing into the late 1950s, with more successes including Three Tall Tales and a particularly distinctive colour visualisation of Alice Dalgliesh's The Thanksgiving Story. In 1957, she published Jane Austen's Sense and Sensibility, which proved to be her last illustrated project, and she died in that year in New York at the age of only 61. American illustrator Garrett Price was born in Bucyrus, Kansas in 1896, but a few years later his family relocated to Saratoga, Wyoming, and that's where he grew up. Although he drew enthusiastically throughout his childhood, he later went on to attend the University of Wyoming to obtain some other unspecified degree. But once he had graduated, he headed for the Art Institute of Chicago, and having completed his studies there, he found a job as a reporter and cartoonist for the Kansas City Star before moving on to the Chicago Tribune. In the early 1920s, he also started contributing to various magazines, and most significantly in 1925, he began working for The New Yorker in its first year of publication. He created a couple of quite graphically stylized modernist covers and became a regular contributor of monochrome jokes for the interior pages. At the same time, he also featured regularly in the human magazine Life, and was one of the illustrators responsible for reviving the magazine's previously dated appeal. The covers he created were light-hearted caricature depictions of the young and carefree characters of the Jazz Age, produced in line and wash and usually set within large flat-coloured areas. His monochrome cartoon work relied on a particularly fine linear technique, which resonated with the slender fashion illustrations of the day, and despite its comedic nature, revealed a high level of expressive anatomical understanding. Oddly, this talent was hard to discern in his comic strip White Boy, which was first published in 1933. The strip featured a teenager who had been captured and raised by Native Americans, and despite its less than dynamic graphic styling, it ran for about 3 years. Life magazine ran aground in 1934, but The New Yorker remained a regular source of income. By this time his style had become noticeably looser. He was still creating covers with ink and wash, but he was now using a far more gestural technique. And this would remain his favoured, although not exclusive, approach for the rest of his career. During the Second World War he created some domestic propaganda work, but The New Yorker would continue to be his main platform and source of income. And from the mid-1940s onwards, his now exclusively organic painting technique was used to great effect on a significant number of the magazine's covers. In the 1950s and into the 1960s, he also illustrated a handful of light comic novels, including a couple written by Francis Gray Patton and three for the Miss Coverlet series written by Mary Nash. In later life, he and his wife moved out to Westport, Connecticut, and although he continued to contribute to The New Yorker, his output slowed down somewhat. And Garrett Price finally retired in 1973, the year his wife died, and he joined her in 1979 when he was 82 years old. Which brings us to the end of this one, and I hope we meet again for the next one.